Moon Books presents for you Witchcraft Into the Wilds by Rachel Patterson. Read for you by Cindy Dionisio. Who am I? I am a witch. Have been for a very long time. Not the green-skinned, warty kind, obviously. The real sort. But I am also a working wife and mother who has also been lucky enough to write and have published a book or three. I love to learn. I love to study, and I've done so from books, online resources, schools, and wonderful mentors over the years, and still continue to learn each and every day, but have learned most from actually getting outside and doing it. I like to laugh and eat cake. I am a high priestess of the Kitchen Witch Coven and an elder of the online Wild Witches Kitchen Witch School. I also have a regular Hedge Witch blog on Witches and Pagans and Beneath the Moon blog on Patheos Pagan. My craft is a combination of old religion witchcraft, kitchen witchery, hedge witchery, and folk magic. My heart is that of a kitchen witch. I am blessed with a wonderful husband, lovely children, a fabulous family, and good friends. Websites. My website. www.rachelpatterson.co.uk. Facebook, www.facebook.com/rachelpattersonbooks. My personal blog, www.tansyfiredragon.blogspot.co.uk. Email, kitchenwitchhearth@yahoo.com. Also, www.kitchenwitchhearth.net. www.kitchenwitchuk.blogspot.co.uk, www.facebook.com/kitchenwitchuk, and www.thekitchenwitchcauldron.blogspot.co.uk. Be careful what you wish for with your wording and the thoughts you put out there. Be mindful of what you say and how you phrase it. Let go of what you don't want and don't need to allow room for what you do. Believe. Chapter 1. The Journey. I would love to take you on a journey, one that leads us through the wilds of nature and back to the roots and bones of witchcraft, a natural witchcraft that works with the seasons and all the beautiful items that Mother Nature provides. Drawing on magical folklore and a bit of hedge witchcraft and gypsy magic, too. No fancy schmancy tools or ceremonial rituals. This is about working with the source. Mother Earth provides us with the changing of the seasons, and within that turning of the year, she gives us everything we need to work magic from natural energy in the form of storms, rain, and sunshine, to tangible items packed full of magical energy such as seeds, leaves, and stones. Just a walk through the fields, a forest, or along the hedgerows or seashore will provide you with a whole host of natural magical items and will help you connect with the energy of the moment. Whatever season, month, or day of the week it might be, nature is our own magical barometer. You can tap into the energy from any place, and each area or location will have its own unique energy. Forests, ponds, parks, streets, seashores, and even city centers will all have that magical energy. It's just a case of plugging yourself into the source. Select a tree or bush that is near you or your home. I have a silver birch tree at the end of my road. Each day I look at it to see how it is and what stage it is at. In the winter, it is dark and bare. Then as spring approaches, I see the tiny green buds starting to form. Then they open and the green leaves start to show fully formed catkins. Throughout the summer, the leaves are bright green, followed by a turning to yellow in the autumn, before they float down, one by one, to the ground, ready once again for the winter slumber. It is my nature calendar, along with the plants in my own small garden. I can look out and tell exactly where we are in the cycle of the year. Get to know your local area. Take regular walks around your locality. Discover all the plants and trees that grow where you live. If you're close to a forest, a park, or the sea, you are very blessed. If you live in a city, you may have to look a little harder, but you will find Mother Nature there too. Have a look in local parks and recreation areas along with your local cemetery and churchyards. Take a notebook with you, and when you go out, write down what you see or take photos of the plants and trees so you can identify them. It doesn't matter whether you live in the city, in the country, on the side of a mountain, or in a high-rise block of flats, magic is all around you. You can throw away the structure and the rules, but only if you want to, and be wild. This is your journey. Take the bits you like, the parts that work for you, and throw them all into your very own and unique mixing pot to create a pathway that belongs to you. Wheel of the Year. When I first started on my pagan journey, I was presented with the Wheel of the Year, which it seemed most pagans worked with. I spent ages trying to remember the dates and learn the names and correspondences. Even to this day, I have to stop and think about it when trying to recall what is what. I also started dressing my altar for each Sabbat and looking up all the correct colors, herbs, and associations to know what to put on it. But I have to admit, I started to lapse, and I realized that I wasn't connecting with the celebrations, and what I was doing was just a mechanical action because I thought I had to. As my journey has deepened and the years have passed, I don't worry about any of it anymore. I don't particularly work with the Sabbats, or at least not the set dates on the calendar, especially as Mother Nature appears to be having a menopausal meltdown here in the UK at the moment, and all the seasons are completely squiffy. I have summer bedding plants in the garden that have continued to flower all winter, and daffodils and hawthorn flowering in January. It has all gone completely mad. In fact, the winters in the past couple years in the UK have not even been that cold. So it makes it quite difficult to celebrate the specific Sabbats when nature isn't playing ball. If you do follow the Wheel of the Year, and it works for you, then please, please continue to do so. I'm not knocking the system. I just want to share with you how I work with the seasons, and it is more on a monthly, weekly, stick-your-head-outside kind of basis, rather than following the set dates on a calendar. It works for me, but it might not work for you. I left the Wheel of the Year behind and started working with the energies of each month. It started a few years ago and has evolved to me working not just with the energies of each month, but sometimes even the specific energies of the week or the day. It is all governed by what nature and the weather are doing at any given time. Also, the energies will vary depending on where you are in the world and how your seasons work. Our ancestors would have welcomed the first day of spring when they saw the signs of growth in the plants and the soil and the warming up of the weather, not because it was February 2nd, in bulk. While it is useful to have the Sabbat dates as a universal guide, the first signs of spring aren't always on a specific date. I struggled when spring was early or late and didn't arrive when the calendar told it to. With the UK having a very mild winter last year, it was hard to acknowledge Yule or the winter solstice when the weather was so warm I didn't even need to wear a coat. So now I follow my intuition and see what the energies of the day, week, or month are going to bring. Be guided by nature. When she starts to send out the first shoots of spring on her plants, when the frosts have finished, when you open the door in the morning and you can feel the warmth of the early morning sun on your face. Listen to the birds. Watch them building their nests. Follow the progress of the baby birds learning to fly. Watch flowers opening on plants and leaves as they journey through the year from buds to green to orange and then fall. Nature is all around you. Even if you live in the city, there will be at least a tree or a bush that will give away the telltale signs of the seasons. Breathe in the air each day and see if you can tell when spring turns to summer, and summer to autumn, and then on to the crisp, cool air of winter. Trust your senses. It's a journey of discovery. Journal. Yep, I know. Nearly every book out there says keep a journal. And you rush out, buy a beautiful notebook and new pens, write on the first day, and then never look at it again. Well, if you're anything like me, at least that's how it plays out. However, if you're going to be out and about and working with plants and natural items, it might be a good idea to keep a record of what you found, where you found it, what it looked like, and so on, just for identification purposes or to know where to find it again. It can also be useful to note down the plant, seed, feather, and whatever magical properties you found worked well for you when using that item. I think it is also useful to keep a journal to record daily energies and weather patterns, and of course a note of what magic you do, how the spell works, and what the results are. You don't need to handwrite it. You can type it up on the computer. That's just a suggestion. And I will give you a helping hand throughout the book with journal prompts in case it helps. But I won't be offended if you ignore them. Energy and ancestors. Each natural item you find or collect out in the wilds will have its own unique energy, and that energy can be used for spell working or meditation. Each pebble will have an energy, probably very earthy, but if you find it by the ocean or a river, then it will also have a watery element to it as well. Each tree, plant, flower, seed, and twig will also carry its own special energy, and will probably have a very definite character and personality. Tap into and connect with that energy. Find out what the item is happy to offer you. Each one will have particular energies, whether it is wisdom, knowledge, healing, protection. The list is long. No two twigs, no two pebbles, no two seed heads will be the same. It is a case of making that connection with the spirit of the item to find out. And you get used to people staring at you while you have a conversation with a twig.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.